wanted to remind everybody that Saturday at 5 o'clock we are meeting at Stringtown Park on 18 for all the young people ages 13 and up. We're going to have a small picnic and some volleyball and just a good time. So be sure to come out.
Also, ladies, don't forget that tomorrow is the second Monday of the month, and we will be having our ladies' fellowship get-together at Maxine's, and we're going to meet here at the church and leave about 6:30. So please, if you plan on going to be with us out at Maxine's for the ladies' meeting, please come to the church here. We will be leaving here at 6:30. So don't show up at 6:31 and wonder where the van went, because we will be gone. So we're going to leave here at 6:30. So if you want to go out, come here and meet at church, and we'll all get on the church van, and I will drive you out there. If you know where she lives and you decide you want to drive out there yourself, you're more than welcome to. Just know that parking is not abundant. So that's why I say it's probably better, if you can, to meet us here at the church, and we will go out. Could we stand? And I'm going to ask Sister Shelley Griffith to lead us out in prayer. Yes. But if you want to look at a book, if you're old school and like a book, it's page 180. There's a happy land of promise over in the great beyond, where the saved and burned shall soon the glory share, where the souls of men shall enter and live on forevermore. Everybody will be happy over there. Everybody.
For us to bear, all the people.
because you know what? I do want more of God. You know, Wayne was preaching about there being a fire wall. You know, a wall of fire. And I thought, you know what? I want to be set on fire. I want to be consumed with you. I want more of you, God. I want more of you, God. Amen. There's no place I would rather be than right here in the presence of His love. Amen. No place I would rather be. No place I would rather be. No place I would rather be than here in your love, here in your love. No place I would rather be. No place I would rather be. No place I would rather be than here in your love, here in your love. So set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain, that I can't control. I want more of you, God. I want more of you, God. Set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain, that I can't control. I want more of you, God. I want more of you, God. No place I would rather be. No place I would rather be. No place I would rather be. Your love, here in your love. No place I would rather be. There's no place.
No place I would rather be.
No place I would rather be.
Than
here in your love, here in your love. To set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain, that I can't control. I want more of you, God. I want more of you, God. To set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain, that I can't control. I want more of you, God. I want more of you, God. No place I would rather be. No place I would rather be. No place I would rather be.
Can you think of a better place?
Yes, there's no place.
No place I would rather be.
No place, no place.
No place I would rather be.
I would rather be
right in your love, here in your love. To set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain, that I can't control. I want more of you. I want more of you, God. I want more of you, God. Set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain, that I can't control. I want more of you, God. I want more of you, God. I want more.
Every praise belongs to our God. Amen. Every praise is to our God. Every word of worship with one accord. Every praise is to our God. Sing hallelujah to our God. Glory hallelujah is to our God.
Every praise is to our God. worship with one accord. Every praise is to our God. Sing hallelujah to our God. Oh, glory, hallelujah is to our God. Every praise is to our God. Worship with one accord. Every praise is to our God.
Sing hallelujah
to our God. Glory, hallelujah is to our God. Every praise is to our God.
Let's do it again.
Every praise is to our God. Every word of worship with one accord. Every praise is to our God.
I love it. Sing hallelujah.
To our God. Glory, hallelujah is to our God. Every praise is to our God.
Glory, hallelujah.
God, my Savior. My healer, God, my deliverer.
Yes, He is.
Yes, He is.
Yes, He is.
God, my Savior.
He's my Savior.
Every word of worship with one accord. Every praise, 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 every praise is to our God.
Let everything that hath breath praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Every praise is to our God. He is Jesus Messiah. Amen.
And He became sin who knew no sin, that we might become His righteousness. He humbled Himself, carried the cross. Love so amazing. Love so amazing. Yeah. Jesus Messiah. Name above all names. Blessed
amazing, yeah.
Lord of all.
Worship tonight. Amen. Normally y'all come back on Sunday night and you're dragging tail, but tonight you act like you're into it. Keep acting. If you're not into it, just at least act that way and you make us feel better. But I want you into it tonight. Amen. And if there's one person I know that don't act like he's into it, it's our next guy coming up here tonight. Todd does not act at all. His excitement is overwhelming. He makes up for me and Robert all the time because sometimes we just come up here and we look like we are dragging.
I will tell you this about our buddy Todd back there.
Come on, Todd.
During the first song we were singing, Everybody Will Be Happy Over There, nobody in this place had a bigger smile on his face than that man right there.
Amen.
I'll tell you. That's so somebody that's looking forward to going home right there. Amen. Amen.
Here in front, so everybody can see you.
I want to dedicate this song to Paul, the preacher. I think the ministry preacher. Is that what they call it?
Minister of music.
Yeah. I want to dedicate this song tonight to Paul, all of them, and Shante tonight. I want somebody to pray for her, and my uncle too, coming back from Yellowstone. Let's do this. Oh, I'm so glad.
I'm so glad Jesus sent me.
Todd. Todd, you want to do another one? I think everybody liked that so well. You got everybody.
Well, come on, buddy.
Candace Land, I will dedicate this song to my dad and my mom, everybody out there on TV. Everybody was very good to me.
Well,
say bye.
On my way, Candace Land.
There's only one person in this whole church that can top that, and that's Keith. Come on up, buddy.
Thank you, Steve. Good evening.
Good evening.
Wow, if only Todd had some enthusiasm. Wow. Everything else just lacking enthusiasm. No, you did a wonderful job, Todd.
Amen.
You really did.
Amen.
I went by just remember Shantae Knight and my Uncle Kenny them coming back from Yellowstone National Park. I want everybody to keep them in prayer.
Amen.
Everybody in my whole family.
I don't have anything else from the wonderful Robert Needham tonight. So I'm going to go ahead and resume going back to the Bible here. I'm going to share something with you.
Wow, that was harsh. Robert
in the Bible, is that what you're saying? I'm just asking. No,
I wasn't equating, no. I was developing the chart. I'm just glad you didn't do what you said you was going to do.
No, I wouldn't do that to you, Robert, honest.
You.
Well, I might, but I didn't. I'm going to share with you actually from Psalm 113 tonight, and this will be the first 8 verses of that. It says, praise ye the Lord. Praise, O ye servants of the Lord. Praise the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord from this time forth and forevermore. From the rising of the sun unto the going down of the same, the Lord's name is to be praised. The Lord is high above all nations, and his glory above the heavens. Who is like unto the Lord our God, who dwelleth on high? Who humbleth himself to behold the things that are in heaven and in the earth. He raiseth up the poor out of the dust, and lifteth the needy out of the dunghill, that he may set him with princes, even with the princes of his own people. Amen?
Amen.
It's time for us to take up our tithes and offerings. Oh, hold it. Time out. That's weak. I mean, after all the enthusiasm Todd just gave us up here, that's weak. We can do a lot better than that. Let's try that again. It's time to take up our tithes and offerings. Okay, I thought I was in the wrong church for just a second. Thank you. Barbara, would you mind praying over the offering tonight, please? Amen.
I can see you're hurting, and I know that you're in pain. And nothing in this life seems worthwhile. You've tried everything to bring you peace of mind. You're looking for someone to mend your broken life. Just one touch. Takes to find your healing that only He can send. You're tired and weary, and your burden you can't bear. Let the Lord take over. He will never fallen beyond His arms of grace, and nothing in this life is worth for you. All you have to do is call upon His name, and instantly He'll take your guilt and shame.
Make 'cause I'm so callous, and now I can't feel. I wanna run to you with heart wide open. Make me broken. Make me empty so I can be filled. 'Cause I'm still holding on to my will, and I'm completed when you are with me.
Gibraltar. It's supposed to be a big old rock, isn't it? Somewhere out in the sea somewhere. There you go. But you know what? I know the one who made that rock.
Amen.
And I go to that rock whenever the storms of life come against me. I go to the rock. Peter declared that he was the rock. Amen. I go to the rock. Where do I go when there's no one else to turn to? Who do I talk to? No one wants to listen. Who do I lean on when there's no foundation stable? I go to the rock. I know he's able. I go to the rock. The rock of my salvation. I go to the stone that the builders rejected. I run to the mountain, and the mountain stands by me. When the earth all around me is sinking sand, on Christ the solid rock I stand. When I need a shelter, when I need a friend, I go to the rock. Oh, where do I hide? Storms have all passed over. Where do I run to when the winds of sorrow threaten? Is the refuge
When my soul needs consolation, I go to the rock. I go to the rock of my salvation. I go to the stone that the builders rejected. I run to the mountain and the mountain stands by me. When the earth all around me is sinking sand, on Christ the solid rock I stand. When I need a shelter, when I need a friend, I go to the rock. Well, where do I go when there's no one else to turn to? Who do I talk to? No one wants to listen. Who do I lean on? When there's no foundation stable, I go to the rock. I know he's able. I run to the rock. Yes, I go to the rock of my salvation. I go to the stone that the builders rejected. I run to the mountain and the mountain stands by me. When the earth all around me is sinking sand, on Christ the solid rock I stand. When I need a shelter, when I need a friend, I go to the rock. Let's do that one more time. I go to the rock of my salvation. I go to the stone that the builders rejected. I run to the mountain and the mountain stands by me. When the earth all around me is sinking sand, on Christ the solid rock I stand. When I need a shelter, when I need a friend, I go to the rock. Yes, when I need a shelter, when I need a friend, I go to the rock.
Working now. All right. How many of you guys are excited to be in God's house tonight? Amen. Amen. Let's give him a hand. There is a good spirit here tonight, and Steve said that it should be easy for me because everybody else kind of brought it. So he was teasing me just a little bit. I'm going to tell on him. He was saying, if you cry, I'll throw handkerchiefs at you. And he thought that would hurt my feelings, but actually that makes me really excited because I don't want to get distracted and have to grab the tissue. So I'm going to throw the box to you, and when you see a tear, you have to bring me one now. He catches like a girl. I'm just kidding. All right, so just kidding. So I do want to share with you just for a moment. I was watching this the other day, this little news clip that I saw on my email, and I wanted to share it with you because it really struck me. And it's one of those stories that when you see it, it kind of sticks with you for a while, and you just keep thinking about it. And I kept replaying the video over in my head. There was a woman who had a newborn baby. And she was on her way to take her baby to the hospital because the baby wasn't breathing right. So she gets on the subway to go to the hospital, and there was a man that followed her on. And this man kept trying to come closer to her and kept saying, "Ma'am, can I see your baby? Can I see your baby?" And this woman just kept ignoring him because she didn't feel safe about it. And finally, this man got so close to her that he tried to grab the baby and grab the blanket off the baby. And that's when the woman looked at him and said, "No, sir." Right? You know, the mama and her came out. And so this woman was utterly helpless because she can't defend herself if she's having to hold the baby, too. And she's stuck on this subway with him. Well, then there was a woman who was on the subway. And this woman was a woman of God, and she saw what was happening. So she came over in between them and she said, if you stick with me, you'll be okay. So she barricades herself on this subway and creates a wall to where no matter how hard this man tried, you better hurry up, it's coming. Thank you. I haven't even started yet. This wasn't even in my notes. Thank you. No matter how hard this man tried, this woman of God, she grabbed on to one of the rails and grabbed the other rail and literally made a wall between herself and this man. And he would try to come around her, and she would lean in this way. And he would try to come the other way, and she would lean back in this way. And the woman, she was interviewed on the Fox News, and the woman said, I started calling out Jesus' name over him. Hallelujah. And I said, Satan, I rebuke you. Yes. I don't know why I'm crying, but I just really feel the Lord in this, but... That's what we're called to do, church. We're not just called to tear down the walls, but we're called to be the wall that this world can depend on, that this world can use as protection and say, Satan, I rebuke you. You will not touch that lady. You will not harm her in any way. And we are called to be that wall, because when we have Christ in our hearts, we can look at Satan in the face and we can say, back up right now. Amen. And he has to go. And that woman, she followed the other lady all the way to the hospital, and she said, I won't leave you. I won't leave you. I'll be right here with you. And that man proved himself to be violent later that night. They said that he attacked a police officer and he was arrested. But that woman was her wall, and nothing came to harm her because she stood in and she called out the Lord's name. Now, truly, that man was a big man. He could have harmed both of them if he wanted to. But the blood of Jesus was over that woman, and nothing can touch that. Amen. Amen. Now that that's over. Sorry about that. If you will, turn to the book of John, chapter 11. I want to share with you this evening. I don't even know what time of day it is, apparently. I want to share with you tonight a message that the Lord's really laid on my heart. And we've been talking about tearing down the walls. And I'm pretty sure all of us, if not every single person in this place, has heard these messages, and if not all of them, but some of them has impacted you in some way, has been a message from the Lord to push you further and to show you where each one of us need to be better and to let the walls come down. But even more so now, it's time to let God rebuild the walls. And the wall is the wall that he intended for us to have all along. It's the wall that he says is best for us. It's the wall of fire. It's the wall of prayer. It's the wall of faith. Amen? So tonight we're going to talk about rebuilding the wall. In John chapter 11, if you turn to verse 17, it starts off with saying this. When Jesus arrived at Bethany, he was told that Lazarus had already been in his grave for 4 days. Bethany was only a few miles down the road from Jerusalem, and many of the people had come to console Martha and Mary in their loss. When Martha got word that Jesus was coming, she went to meet him, but Mary stayed in the house. Martha said to Jesus, Lord, if only, everybody say, if only, you had been here, my brother would not have died. But even now, I know that God will give you whatever you ask. Jesus told her, your brother will rise again. Yes, Martha said, he will rise when everyone else rises at the last day. Jesus told her, I am the resurrection and the life. Anyone who believes in me will live, even after dying. Everyone who lives in me and believes in me will never, ever die. Do you believe this, Martha? Let's go before the Lord tonight and pray. Heavenly Father, God, we thank you for this opportunity to be in your house, Lord. We thank you for your sweet presence that we feel here tonight through worship, through prayer, through your word. God, I pray that you will let yourself be made known to us. God, that you will speak your word in power, speak your word with authority. God, we pray right now that you will just anoint our hearts, anoint our ears to receive the word that you have for us tonight. God, let me be your vessel tonight, Lord, and let your words be spoken out clearly. And let it just rest on our hearts, Lord, and do what it has been sent to do, God, to change lives and to save souls, Lord. In the mighty name of Jesus, we give you all the glory and all the praise. And everybody said, amen. Amen. All right, so tonight, thank you. Tonight, I want to talk to you for a few moments about rebuilding the wall. And in this story, this is a story that I was sharing with my Sunday school class, and we were touching on a few different things that you can pull out of this story. And it's a great miracle. Most of you, if not all of you, are familiar with this story from the Bible when Jesus raises Lazarus from the dead. But you see, Lazarus was a man of God. He was a friend of God. And when he had died, he was laid in peace. And that could have been the end of the story. It would have been okay. Everything would have been just fine if he had left it like that. Mary and Martha were friends of God as well. They were friends of Jesus. They believed in Jesus. Lazarus had believed in Jesus as well. And I'm fully confident that Lazarus was on his way to heaven. But you see, there was grief in that place. That's normal. That's expected when death comes. It's okay to grieve. It's okay to mourn. But it's not okay to let your faith die in your grief. And I believe that what was happening to Martha especially was her grief had become so overwhelming for her. Her faith was beginning to die in her grief because she's kind of wavering in the way she's talking to Jesus. She's saying, Jesus, I know that God will give you whatever you ask. And I know that my brother will rise again one day. But see, she didn't have that attitude of, God, you can do this even now. You see, Jesus had come not just to call out the physically dead. He had come to call out the spiritually dead as well. He was walking to Bethany with a purpose. He delayed himself on purpose. You see, he told his disciples, he said, if we just wait a little while, God will get the glory for it. You see, the very purpose of Jesus coming to earth was to give us life, to give us a hope, and to give God all the glory for it. You see, it's not because of anything that we have done or anything that we have earned that we can expect God's blessings or we can expect eternal life, but it's only by Jesus Christ and his love for us that we can cling to that hope, that we can cling to that faith, that we are saved, that we are entering into glory, that we are favored by God, and that's what he was coming to call his people out. He was looking at that woman. He was saying, do you believe this? You see, I believe that life can leave us a little messed up sometimes. Life can come at you and it can leave your faith feeling a little messed up. Life can hit you hard. Life can leave you feeling knocked down. It can leave you feeling bruised. It can leave you feeling tattered and torn. And when you stand up and you look at the walls that you've let God take down, yet your faith is still a little wavered because of the life that you've been through. And that's okay. But it's not okay to leave it like that. It's not okay to let your faith die in your grief or let your faith die in your disappointments or let your faith die in your past or your faith die in the past that you've, or the sins that you've done or the things that you used to do. Let your faith live again. You see, and I believe tonight God is calling out some of us from our cowardice, from our fears, from our past, and he's saying, do you really believe that I can rebuild this stuff? Do you really believe that I am who I say I am? Do you really believe that I am the God that can call down fire and consume everything that's been trying to burn you up? Do you believe that I am the God who is able to do exceeding and abundantly above all that you ask or think? Do you believe it? If you believe it, give God some praise. You see, tonight, what I was trying to get my notes together
there's a lot of commentary on this story, but nothing was really going with what I feel like God was taking me in the direction of it, and it was that God had a purpose for Martha. She had a moment with Jesus, and there's a lot of people, there's even books about Martha, just her alone. But you see, there's a lot of people who have a harsh opinion on her. But see, she was human. She had lost her brother. She had expected Jesus to come. She was human. And God was not rebuking her for being human. He was not rebuking her for being sad or being upset. He was rebuking that fear that says her faith isn't good enough or that Jesus isn't who he says he is. He was rebuking that thing that makes us doubt, that makes us fear, that makes us say that he's not able to do what he said. And he rebukes it so that he can get it out of the way and he can say, do you believe it or not? You see, Jesus didn't come just to patch up our old walls. He didn't come just to patch up our old lifestyle. He didn't come and meet us where we are so he can just give us a quick fix and send us back on our way. He came so that we can have life and have it more abundantly. He came so that we can have life and life to the fullest, so that we could be made whole, so that we could be restored, so that we could be made new again. He didn't come just to tear your walls down and leave you hopeless and leave you helpless. He came to give you something new, something that's better, something that's good, something that will help you, something that will show everyone in this world that you can be a wall, not only to a helpless woman, but you can be a wall for your family, you can be a wall for your future, you can be a wall for this whole entire world. If you want to be that wall, say amen. You see, it talks about this man named Abraham, and there's a lot of verses you can go to in faith, but my favorite verses on faith is in Romans 4 when it talks about Abraham. In verse 17, it says this, if they can get it up. That is what the scriptures mean when God told him, I have made you the father of many nations. This happened because Abraham believed in the God who brings the dead back to life and who creates new things out of nothing. Everybody say, new things. Say it like you mean it. New things out of nothing. And Abraham's faith did not weaken, even though at about 100 years of age, he figured his body was as good as dead, and so was Sarah's womb. Abraham never wavered in believing God's promise. In fact, his faith grew stronger, and in this he brought glory to God. He was fully convinced that God is able to do whatever he promises. And because of Abraham's faith, God counted him as righteous. You see, if you read all of chapter 4, it talks about how it's not because Abraham lived by the law. Pastor Wayne touched on that this morning. There's no one who can live up to the law but Jesus. There's no one who could even touch the law. If we can't live in the law, then the only other hope for us is to live in the grace of God. And Abraham, a man who wasn't around when Jesus came to earth to die for our sins, a man who only had the law to cling to hope for, to try to live by, he still couldn't do it because he's human. See, Abraham wasn't a man who was perfect. Abraham wasn't a man who never got upset, never worried, never doubted, never feared, but Abraham believed in God. And it's because he believed in God that God counted him as righteous. You see, God doesn't require you to pray just right, to fast just right, to read your Bible just right. He doesn't require you to come to church every single Sunday to do all these things and wear just the right clothes and do just the right things and say just the right things and look the part, act the part. That's not his requirement. Yes, you should pray. Yes, you should read. Yes, you should fast. Yes, you better be in church or we'll kick your butt. But God says, just believe. Just believe. You see, it's because Abraham believed that even though it looked like it was good as dead, even though he thought he had missed the prime of his life, God looked down at this man who believed in him and he said, you know what? Just because I love you, just because I want to do something good for you, just because I want to bless you, I'm going to give you a son, and not just a son, I'm going to give you a legacy. It's going to be the legacy that everyone talks about and sings about. Even in 2014, you're still going to be sung about, Abraham. They're still going to mention you in sermons. They're still going to mention you in Sunday schools. They're still going to mention you in children's church. You see, in 2014, you can be just like that. You can be that wall. You can be that man or woman of God who stands up and says, even though everything looks like it's falling apart, even though everything looks as good as dead, it's so dead it stinks, all I need is Jesus. All I need is the Lord to step in. All I need is the Lord to help me out. You see, all you need is God to step in. All you need is God to have that moment when he says, you don't have to wait till the last minute. Just let your faith last you till the last minute and I'll step in. You see, God's not a God who leaves you hanging until the end. He says, let your faith be strong enough to last you till the end. And watch what I do with that. Watch where I step in where no one else could. Watch where I work it out where the doctor says it was over. Watch where I work it out where the bank said, oh, you're done, get out of here. Watch where I work it out where everybody else said it's over with. It's done. Even if it's so dead it stinks, God can do something with it. I was driving through Grant County yesterday on my way to Crystal's house. I don't live there anymore. I don't live in those parts of the woods anymore. And I had the windows down. I was breathing in the green and remembering how pretty it was out there and everything. And she lives back in the boonies of Williamstown, you know? And I was coming around this curve, and it was such a pretty day yesterday, and all of a sudden, something filled the car, right? And I happened to dash over and look, and there was a dead deer. So sad. It stunk, okay? It's pretty out there, but when there's something dead, it doesn't matter how pretty of a day it is. It doesn't matter how nice it looks. It doesn't matter how nice the weather is. You can have, you know, the prettiest perfume on. If something dead creeps in, it's all you can think about. It's all that you can notice, and you just can't drive fast enough past it, right? You see, you can be a child of God, and you can look the part. You can act the part. You can do your part. But if there's something in you that's dead, if there's something in you that's just not quite right where it needs to be with God, it is so dead it stinks. It doesn't matter how much perfume you put on. It doesn't matter how much aftershave you wear. It doesn't matter how nice your tie is. If it's so dead it stinks, that's all that you're going to be thinking about. That's all that you have in the back of your mind. And if you don't get it right with God, it will eat its way at you to where that isn't it, your view of that pretty mountain isn't so pretty anymore. All you see is the negative. All you see is how God didn't move the way you asked him to move. All you see is the way God hasn't shown up yet for you. All you see is how God hasn't helped you with certain things yet, and that thing just keeps eating away at you and eating away at you, and no matter how much you try to put on, God still says, I have to fix it. You have to let me fix it. You see, Jesus was stepping down, and he was getting away from everybody, and Martha had come out to meet him. You see, and Martha, this woman of God, her faith was dying. She was grieving, and she was sad. And she said, Lord, if only you had been here. Abraham and Sarah, they maybe have thought, Lord, if only you had said this like 40 years ago. Lord, if only you had promised this like maybe even 10 years ago, I would have taken that. But it's over, God. It's done. Martha said, he's been dead 4 days, Jesus. It's over. It's gone. It's done. It doesn't matter anymore. See, you may be in a place with God where there are certain things that you can just deal with it, right? But you're really not dealing with it. You're just getting by with it. Because if you were dealing with it, if your faith was dealing with it, then it wouldn't be an issue anymore. You would still be praising. You would still be counting those blessings. But if there's something dead, if there's something stinking, if there's something that's eating away at you, then it's not really been dealt with yet. So you have to remind God, you know what, God, here it is again. And see, Martha wasn't ready to do that. She was saying, it's over, it's done. Let's just go, right? Let's just move on. But you see, Jesus didn't take that. He pushed aside her doubt. He pushed aside her fear. He pushed aside all of her naysayers, all of those if onlys, buts. And he said, do you believe that I am the I am? Do you believe I am the life? Do you believe that I am the resurrection? Do you believe that I am the way, the truth, and the life? Because if you can just believe it, then you can see your brother live again. And not just live again, but come back whole. Come back even better than he was before. You can see him come back and live an even longer life that is blessed and good and perfect. You can see your own life be blessed and good. It may not be perfect. It may not be the simplest life you ever had. But you know what? If God's in it, then it's a good life. Then it's the best kind that you can have. It's a life that is favored. It's a life that is anointed, that is blessed, that is counted as highly favored and righteous. You see, I don't want to just make it in. I want God to point me out and say, I called her righteous. You see, Jesus was working on something. He was working on Martha's faith. He was working on the dead. He was working on a lot of things for her. He had a plan for her. You see, there are a lot of people who say that the women don't count, right? Let me just tell you a quick little story. I have a lot of family that are Baptist, and that's cool. High five the Baptist, right? They believe Jesus too. They worship God just like we worship God, just a little different sometimes. So I'm sitting there at my family's house, and her husband, his name is Ed. It's my Aunt Pat's house. I'm sitting there and hanging out. Her husband's Baptist, and there are some Baptists that, you know, are a lot like Pentecostals, and there are some that are just, they're Baptists, you know, like straight up Baptist. And he is a man who doesn't believe that women should preach. He's a man that he doesn't believe that women should even have any kind of role in the church, and that's okay if you know what, let them do their thing, right? So I'm sitting there and I'm just hanging out, and his grandson Riley comes in, and he's sweet, and he always likes to bug me a lot, and I give him gum and then he leaves me alone. But he's sitting there and he was like, what do you do? And I was like, I'm just here. And then I was like, and I was telling him what I do at my job, and that's kind of boring. And I was like, but I'm a preacher too. I want to be in with the 10-year-old, right? So he was like, what? No way. And I was like, yeah, man, I'm a preacher. I was like, and I teach and stuff. And he was like, wait, my dad said that girls can't preach. And I was like, oh, I had forgotten who I was talking to for a minute, right? And I was like, I'm not about to say your dad's wrong. So I was like, Lord, how do I say this to a 10-year-old, right? He asked me what I do, so I told him. I can't help it that he was told that it's wrong. So I was like, well, that's okay if your dad says that. And he was like, really? And I was like, and he was like, so is it right or is it wrong? And I was like, I think it's right because God told me to do it, you know? And he was like, well, my dad preaches too. And I was like, I bet I'm better. And then my mamaw, she chimes in. She was like, my pastor is a woman. And then you could see like his wheels were turning. He was like, the whole world was like spinning around him. Like I thought I knew what was going on and I totally don't kind of moment. And then I was just like, let's go play basketball. You know, like, let's just skip this subject. But then because that's kind of sticky. And but at 10, all I have to say is, this is what I do. I don't have to defend myself. I don't have to prove his dad wrong. I'm not really in that kind of a business. But I was honest with him. And at some point, when he gets a little older, when he meets another woman of God who preaches, maybe, just maybe, if he knows that I'm the real deal, if he knows that I am who I say I am a woman, I'm a child of God, and I'm a preacher too, but I'm real about it, maybe then, if another woman of God comes along and tries to minister to him, he might just be open to it because he knows that, well, she was real. So maybe she could be real too. You see, it's not so hard to tell the real from the fake. You see, because when you get around someone who's real, their faith doesn't stink. Their talk doesn't stink. Their walk doesn't stink. When you get around someone who is real, whether they're man or woman, child or adult, if they know God, if they believe God, then whenever you hit them with an insult or you hit them with something that tries to knock them down, if they're real, they're going to stand up, they're going to square their shoulders back, and they're going to say, that's okay, because my God is better, my God is greater, my God is awesome, my God will see me through, my God will help me, my God will be my wall of fire. He will eat up all those little things that try to get at me, all those little things that try to pluck at your brain and say, you're not good enough, you're not going to make it, you're not going to do it. God says, yes, you can. Amen. Give God a hand clap. I want to end with a few more verses, and then we're going to be wrapping it up. In John chapter 11, going down to verse 34, Jesus was ready to address the situation. He said, they thought Jesus meant Lazarus was simply sleeping. It's the wrong verse. That's okay. When you get verse 34, just let me know. It says, you see, Jesus, he is our hope, he is our anchor, he is our wall of protection, and he is in this kind of business where he doesn't just want to do it all for us. You see, Pastor Wayne mentioned it, you don't want to be a spiritual brat, basically, where you just sit back and say, God, gimme, gimme, gimme. Sometimes that's fun, but sometimes when you're sitting on a subway and there's a man coming at you, you can't say, hang on, let me go pray about this real fast and see what God does for me. Sometimes you just got to square up, put your hand on that rail and say, in the name of Jesus, back up right now. In the name of Jesus, get away from me. In the name of Jesus, God is calling you out and saying you need to step aside. You see, when you have Christ out in your heart, you can look the devil square in the eye and say, greater is he that's in me than he that is in the world. If you put one hand on me, in Jesus' name, I'm going to make you curb stomp the floor right now. See, sometimes we have to get a little real with the devil. Sometimes we have to get a little more real with the enemy. And when he comes at us, we have to show him who's boss. Verse 34 says, where have you put him? He asked them. They told him, Lord, come and see. Then Jesus wept. The people who were standing nearby said, see how much he loved him. You know what? Jesus was fully God, but he was fully man. He was not a man who did not understand her situation. He was not a God who didn't understand what real grief was. He was not a God who didn't understand what real sorrow was, because that's the same Son of God who stepped down and took our sins for us and took our grief for us and took our sorrow for us so that we didn't have to carry it around anymore. But some said, this man healed a blind man. Couldn't he have kept Lazarus from dying? Jesus was still angry as he arrived at the tomb, a cave with a stone rolled across its entrance. Roll the stone aside, Jesus told them. But Martha, the dead man's sister, protested, Lord, he has been dead for 4 days. The smell will be terrible. Jesus responded, didn't I tell you that you would see God's glory if you believe? So they rolled the stone aside. Then Jesus looked up to heaven and said, Father, thank you for hearing me. You always hear me. But I said it out loud for the sake of all these people standing here so that they will believe you sent me. Then Jesus shouted, Lazarus, come out. And the dead man came out, his hands and feet bound in grave clothes, his face wrapped in a head cloth. Jesus told them, unwrap him and let him go. You see, when life looked hopeless for the Hebrew people and all of their baby boys were threatened, a woman placed her baby boy in a basket and sent him down the river when life was looking hopeless. But God led that basket to Pharaoh so that he could raise up the future leader of God's people. You see, when life looked hopeless for a widow and people were coming after her sons to pay off her debts, God said, I'm going to take care of this for you too. Just get some jars. Sometimes when we pray and we ask God to fix our situation, we're not prepared for his answer. If you say, God, I owe like $10,000, God says, get you a jar. Save your quarters and get a jar. Because he didn't just give her just enough to pay off her debt. He gave her more than enough. Because see, we're a God, we serve a God who is about giving us more than enough. You see, when life looks helpless for Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, and their death was sure, and the king was kicking them into the furnace, you see, God said, let me send you somebody that's going to help you out. You see, even if it means going into the flames, even if it means going into a river, even if it means cleaning out the jars, even if it means your faith looks like it's not going to last, even if it looks like you're at the very last minute of the situation and it's about to get ugly, even if it does, let your faith make you strong. Let your faith let you stand tall. Let your faith be your help. Let your faith be your wall that says, get the jars out. Get the basket out. Get the flames a little hotter, because my God can do even better than that. How hot can you get it? The Bible says that the king made it even 7 times hotter than normal, and God still saved them from that too. You see, God is a God who can save you from anything. He will help you through anything if you believe. Give God a hand clap if you believe in him tonight. You see, God was calling out Lazarus, but he was also calling out Martha. He was calling out the doubters who were even talking about him as he was walking up to the dead man's tomb at the moment. He was calling out the doubters. He was saying, come out from your cowardice. Come out from your doubt. Come out from your fear and believe in me. You see, tonight I want to be a woman of God who believes in him, who believes that he is who he says he is. You see, we get to this place where we've prayed for something for so long, or we've carried a burden for so long that we get comfortable with just dealing with it. But you see, that's not what God called you to do. God didn't come so that you could have life and have life that you could just deal with. He came so that you could have life and have it more abundantly, so that you could have life that is full, a life that is whole and complete and perfect. You see, God says, let me have a little moment with this. Let me have a moment where I help you with this. You see, the Bible says, if you believe. And Mark, it says, all things are possible if you believe. So if you've been praying for the baptism of the Holy Ghost and it hasn't come, do you believe that he's going to baptize you with the Holy Ghost or not? If you have been praying over a financial situation and it doesn't look like it's going to get any better, and you say, can I just deal with it and go on? Do you believe God is the God who owns a cattle on a thousand hill or not? Do you believe God is a God who can make new things out of nothing, who can perfect a marriage, who can heal a marriage, who can save your children, who can make your family whole and complete again? Do you believe it or not? Yeah. You see, what happens when these walls come down and you're ready to rebuild, God's brushing away the rubble and he's saying, now we need to deal with you. See, you dealt with the walls, now it's time to deal with you. You see, God was calling Martha out. And he was saying, Martha, we got to work on you. We need to help you. See, God doesn't want to hurt you or be mean to you. He wants to help you. Sometimes it feels bad. Sometimes it hurts. Sometimes it's not pleasant, but it's to help you. You see, God says, where there's anger, we need to deal with that. Where there's fear, we need to deal with that. Where there's hurt, we need to deal with that. If you want to build this new wall, it means we have to build a new you too. If you want to build a new wall, then you need a new mind. You need a new attitude. You need a new spirit. You need a new strength. You need a new heart. Because God didn't come just to patch it up and plug the holes up. He came to give you a new wall of protection, a new wall of fire, a new wall of prayer, a new wall of His Spirit. And He says, now we need a new you. You see, what happens, though, is when God starts to work and He starts to move, Satan starts to move, too. He starts to talk to you. He starts to say, it's not going to work. God can't do that. You've been doing this for years. How is it going to work now? You see, I was talking to my mamma the other day, and I was telling her, I was telling on the devil, really. I was like, mamma, let me tell you what the devil's been telling me lately. I started listing off these things, and she goes, well, honey, you know what that just proves to me? And I was like, what? She goes, he is as big a liar as the Bible says he is. And I was like, it's true. And so we were praying, and she said, do you ever have those moments, if you're younger and you know what I'm talking about, your parents do that reverse psychology thing on you, or they try, and you know what they're doing, but you just play along just to kind of get it over with a little bit, you know? She tried to do that. And she was like, well, tell me if you can answer that. I'm just wondering. And like, when she talks a certain way when I already know what she's doing, and I'm like, I've known you for 24 years. I know what you're doing, because that one back there does it too. And they talk a certain way. Well, let me see. What do you think if you're in a battle and Satan's talking to you? What do you do? I mean, he's going to do this your whole life. What are you going to do? Like, how do you fix it? And so she turns it around on me, and I'm like, well, and I knew what she wanted me to say. But when you're in the moment, you're just like, I just want to have my moment. I felt like Martha standing there. Jesus, I believe in you, but he's dead. It's over. He's been in there for 4 days. This is what it is. But you see, Jesus is saying, it's not what it is, because I am what it is. I am the life. I am the way. I am the truth. And when my mama was telling me, what are you going to do about it? I said, I'm going to read my Bible. Yes. Wow. I'm going to pray. Yes. I'm going to fast. Amen. She goes, how do you defeat the enemy? I said, with the word. And she said, give me a word. Tell me what to say. And I said, she goes, how do you know that's what to do? How do you know that's what's going to beat him? And I said, because the Bible says in 1 Timothy that every word is that every scripture is God breathed, and that it's sharper than any two-edged sword. It'll cut you going in and going out. And she said, that's what's going to kill him off. That's what it's going to kill off, those doubts and those fears and those things that he tries to tell you. You keep cutting him down with the word, and it'll get smaller and smaller and smaller. And I thought I knew what she was doing. I knew that I was walking into that reverse psychology thing, but I didn't know it was really going to work. Aren't you glad when the word works? You see, let me just tell you something. When I was a kid, I'm going to close after this. When I was a kid, I was telling myself, it's kind of funny. I was that kid that I wasn't always a Christian, okay? At 7, I knew how to lie, right? She says, amen. I sit back and I would make up stories about what my brother had done, and he hadn't done anything. He was bad too, trust me, he deserved it. So I'd make up all these stories, and he would get in trouble, right? And he would just say, just you wait till I get out of this corner, right? So then he would actually do something bad. Well, then I got smart about it, because that wasn't getting me anywhere. I was having to run and hide and, you know, get too crafty for that. So I gave that one up. So I just got really good at hiding in the background, sitting back, right? I got really good at eavesdropping. I got really good at listening to conversations I wasn't supposed to. And so when my brother and all my cousins were talking and doing things that were wrong, and I would just sit and watch them, right? I wouldn't do it too. I would just kind of sit back and be like, you want to go play outside and you're not supposed to? Oh, you're gonna do that too? Whoa, oh, wow, you guys are tough. And I would start slinking back, and they'd be like, where are you going? I'm going to go talk to Mom. Just want to talk to her. And then we would sit there, and I remember having this huge group of cousins over, right? And they were all telling all these stories about, no, I did this, and oh, I snuck out, and I did this, and I just sat back, and I was like, oh, my gosh, this is perfect. I was like 9 years old, and they just looked at me, and I was smiling. They were like, what are you? I'm just, wait till I talk to Mom. I've got so much on you guys now. And I was like, the TV will be all mine. The video games will be all mine. You guys are going to be grounded for the rest of the day. It's all mine. And so they nicknamed me the snitch baby, right? Because I was always running and talking to Mom and telling on them, right? And that's cool. I owned it. That's who I was. But you know what? I'm going to carry that over to my adulthood. And when Satan starts talking to me and he starts messing with me, I'm going to be like, just wait till I talk to Jesus. Jesus, look at what he's saying to me this time. Jesus, look at what he's trying to talk to me about this time. Look, he's trying to do this again. You already whipped his butt once over this. Go whip him again. And when the Satan starts talking to me, I'm going to tell him you shut up, or I'm going to tell on you again. If you don't start talking to me the right way, you don't start talking to me like a woman of God's supposed to be talked to, you wait till I talk to my daddy in heaven, and he's going to kick your butt all over again. Too many Christians are sitting down and trying to please the world and fit in with the world, fit in with the complacency, fit in with the comfortable attitudes, fit in with the comfortable faith, and don't ever stand up and say, God, this isn't how it's supposed to be. God is starting to be like the old times. God is starting to look like the old days. But God, build it up again. Start all over in me again. Make me new again. Beat him down one more time. Do what I cannot do and make my faith new again. He is doing a new thing. This is my last verse, and then I'm done, for real, done. Isaiah 43:19 says this, for I am about to do something, what? Yes. New. See, I have already begun. Do you not see it? I will make a pathway through the wilderness. I will create rivers in the dry wasteland. He is already working something new in you. He is the author and the finisher of our faith. When he starts a good work, he completes that good work. And even though you didn't let him have permission to start it, he's going to finish it anyways. Amen. Will you stand with me tonight? You see, God is a God who makes things new. He makes things good. You know, when you get something in the mail and it's brand new, it works great. Sometimes it gets old. Sometimes it gets broken. But that's okay. Go buy a new one, right? Because when it's new, it's better. When your attitude is new in God, it's better. When your faith is new in God, it's better. When your wall is new with God, it's better. Everybody say it's better. You see, he's building a new thing in you. But you have to let him. You can't say, God, if only, chuck it aside and let him have it all. Amen. You see, Martha, she had been so used to carrying that sorrow, carrying that grief, that even as she followed Jesus to the tomb, she said, God, just let me deal with it and get over with it. Get it over with. And Jesus said, that's not what I've called you to do. God has called us out, church. He's called us out into his light, his marvelous light. With every head bowed and every eye closed, if you are here tonight and you do not know Jesus, this is your moment. This is your moment to come forward and accept him into your heart and let him do something new in you. Let him give you a new life. Father, in Jesus' name, I pray, Lord, that if there is anyone lost, if there is anyone that is not saved tonight, God, I pray that you will bring them closer to you, God, that you will bring them to this altar, Lord. God, we invite you here tonight. Lord, we pray that you will save souls, that you will heal hearts, God, that you will heal bodies, that you will renew minds and renew faith tonight. God, let your will be done in this place. In Jesus' name. If you are here tonight and you say, I'm ready for that new thing, then you come and you claim it and you stand before God and you let him give it to you. You let him begin the work in you. Let's find ourselves a place to pray tonight.
I give myself away. I give myself away so you can use me. I give myself away. I'm
Play and they're doing fantastic. My babies are up here playing music and they're getting better. I leaned over and told Misty, I said, you notice my wife's getting better? Amen. I harassed the daylights. I said, woman, you got to get some new songs. And she's got some new songs. Amen. And I see her worshiping more and getting involved more when it comes to praise and worship and altar calling. Some of them think that when Paul comes back, they're going to go back to their old sitting on the pew thing. That ain't happening. Amen? Because one thing that you have to know about me is once I see you up and you're doing that good, you're staying up. Amen? I would stack, and I mean this pridefully, if you will, but in a good way, I would stack the mission people against any church, any musicians, any preachers anywhere. Because we are blessed, and I mean that sincerely. Steve came up to me the other night whining about me bragging about Jim and say I never brag on Steve any at all. Steve is a great worship leader. He's a great preacher. He's a great teacher. But I will say he wasn't that great until he came to the mission. So
amen.
I'll just give you that. Amen. We are truly, I mean, and I mean it sincerely, we are truly blessed. And I don't know if you recall me saying this, but I said if ever a church or ever a pastor or somebody comes to me and say, Pastor, how do you do it? I told you, I would say, I want you to talk to these people. Well, that happened this weekend. And sometime soon, I'm going to be tapping some of you, and some of you can tag along if you want to. We're going to go train some workers at another church. It's down in Waco, Kentucky, close to Irvin.
Richmond and Irvin.
I sat and talked to a pastor yesterday, and his question was, Pastor, how do you get people motivated? How do you get them active in church? Amen. And I said, well, Norman probably remembers some of this. I said, in the beginning, it was me and my kids and a few others that would set up, tear down, clean up, whatever. And I said, then along the way, we got new people that came in and they just jumped in full barrel, full bore, and really helped us. And he was asking, what do I do with this greeter team? I said, well, I got a man that I'll bring down to you and he'll teach your whole team how to be a greeter. Amen. And you'll do a good job. He said, well, what do I do about this? I said, well, you know what? I got a few people I'll bring down, and I'll let them tell your people how to do that. Amen. So we will be doing that soon, and I'm kind of excited to watch you training somebody else. Amen. And I promise you, that's not going to be the last time. It's always been this pastor's goal to at least start two more churches. And I'm not saying leave here and start them. I'm saying birth them out of here. And I watch you folks, you know, I'm watching you grow. I'm watching Marcus over here. I'm expecting things out of him. I'm watching Donna. She's teaching now. I'm expecting things out of her. And I'm expecting you folks at some point to step up and be used of God. Talked to the overseer this weekend or this last week. Or he sent an email or a letter or something to me. I forget which. And he was talking about how There is a void of trained ministers now coming up. The age group that Amanda's in, and I had a conversation with her about it, the age group that Amanda's in and just a little bit older, there are no new ministers coming up right now. And it's sad. It's extremely sad. And I'm going to tell you why that's happened. Because pastors like me get stingy with what they've got. I'm going to say it again. Pastors like me get stingy with what they've got. We want to keep everything we have, and we're afraid that if we train them, we're going to lose them. But can I tell you something about training a minister? Churches, pastors, members, you need to train them, and if you lose them, you're going to lose them to the kingdom. And that's what we're supposed to be doing. It's supposed to be our job, our mentality, our heart, to birth new churches, to birth new ministers, to birth new voices that can speak to people in a way that I can't speak to them. Somebody said the other night, Dave can speak to people that I can't do that. JT can speak to a group of people I can't speak to. But should I be jealous and should I hold tight? No. I should let them go do what they need to do. Somebody say amen. So if we can go down and train a church, saints of God, we're planting. We've got Tito in El Salvador doing his job. You know what? Praise God. He's down there doing what we taught him. And I think that's just awesome, amen? And these kids and these musicians, these singers that are up, we're training them. My kids are not allowed to leave me to go anywhere else. That's the rule. At least until I retire, amen? That's the way it works. Lori's saying, uh-huh, because we did that. But we are blessed. We are truly blessed people. And saints, I was sitting there thinking, good message tonight, Amanda. I was building one in my head to top that. But anyway, it was a good message. But I was seriously thinking, you know, we can be the wall. We should be the wall. We should be the bearer. We should be the standard. Somebody say amen. God needs to raise up a standard of people, a standard of faith, a standard of worship, a standard of the Spirit. He needs to raise that up here in these last days. I didn't realize we were going to have this much fun with these two topics when we planned them out. But what the messages that are coming and the songs that are coming, they're coming out. And I'm like, man, I never even thought of it that way. But you know what? It's good. And who sent me the text today? Lorena. How many times is it in there? The word wall is in scriptures 234 times. And in the text, she said, that's a lot of messages. I said, yes, it is. Amen. I could preach on this forever. Don't think you didn't know what I was doing. Amen. Or I didn't know what I was doing. I got this text today, and it kind of made me shout. You know, I can't talk. Mary and Rhonda, they're down at a funeral today of their nephew, or Mary's nephew, Rhonda's cousin. How many deaths have they dealt with in the last
6, 7
15 deaths since August? How many of you have dealt with 15 deaths since August? Well, here's what I know about that many deaths. That'll rob the joy right out of you. That will zap you. That'll sit you flat. That'll steal all your joy. You'll think God's out to get you. Something. Then I got this. Just leaving West Liberty, but wanted to share something with you. On the final viewing, Mom hugged Pat, which is this man's mom, and they both lost it. Then Mom went up to the casket for one last goodbye, and I was right on her heels. She leaned over him, whispered, then went forward, but came right back up, praising God. Mom shouted right by the casket. I said, now that's how Pentecostals do it. Now, you know, saints of God, I'm going to tell you, that family has dealt with a lot of death in the last few months. But raising up a wall of praise at a casket, now that's what you got to be doing. Somebody say amen. That is what you got to be doing. So you might say, Pastor, that's not the right place to shout. Hogwash. This man that died, I don't know how many times I've been called out to go to the hospital. I even drove down to Lexington not too long ago, Tessie, to sit by his bedside waiting on him to die, and he pulled through. I don't know how many times this man has pulled through. Don't know how many times he said the sinner's prayer since August, but you know what? If all those times he said it, if it stuck, you know where he's at today? He's in the glory world shouting around somewhere. Somebody say amen. And I am looking forward to getting there. Give God a huge hand clap. Amen. I hope you love your church as much as I do. And I hope you love those people on the pew next to you as much as I do. This handsome dude in the back, wave at him, Mr. Handsome Dude. Wave at him. Brian. There we go. Man, all of you guys should have raised your hand. I gave you a chance. Hey, man, I gave you a chance. I said, handsome. Pretty boy, you missed. Anyway. All right. He fixed our van seat for us. Amen. And he fixed some other things on there. So give him a hand clap. And I like it when I ask people how much they owe, and they say, oh, nothing. I'm a cheapskate. Norman's got it. Amen. I love it when people don't charge. So, Norm, you going to give your money back? Oh, okay. Let's all stand, please. Very, very proud of our church. Very pleased with you. Very excited to be your pastor. I'm excited to see what's going to happen. And I believe there are things going to happen. I want you all to be praying with us. I don't know if you've watched our numbers as of late. It is summertime. We do dip just a little bit. Keith, our treasurer over here, will tell you, we've not dipped like we typically dip. Because usually this time of year, last year at this time, I think we were panicking just a little bit, or was it 2 years ago? I forget which. We were panicking a little bit, but we've not dipped, saints of God, and it's because you're faithful to your church. And my thinking is, and this is why I'm planning on this wall thing over here, my thinking is once summer's over, this place might really fill up. So if it fills up, you'd better be praying and fasting, because I don't know what we're going to do after that. Once we move a wall, I really have no clue. So we're going to have faith in God. We're going to have to believe in God. We may have to go to two or three services on a Sunday morning. I don't know. So you preachers had better be ready. Amen. Because I'm not preaching them all myself. Amen. So just be ready. Just be excited about what God's doing. If God brings new people in, love on them. Be good to them. Get to know them. Be their friend. Don't be judgmental. Don't be harsh. Just love them. If you love them, we'll keep them. I have noticed we have run some out of here as of late. Did you notice? And you know what scares them? Membership. Did y'all see it? We brought some folks up for membership the other day, and somebody got up and left. A little while back, I think when we brought Isa in, we had some people get up and left. You know what they think? They think we're a cult, man.
We're not.
It's okay. You got the Kool-Aid in the nursery? We don't only have grape, by the way. We can give you any flavor you want. Amen. Any flavor you want, we'll have it. I'm enjoying it. Amen. May, could you lead us out in prayer? Amen. Shake hands and be friendly.
You